Mr. B. Dhanasegar is working as a lecturer in Department of Information Technology, Anna University, Chennai. He finished his MCA from Urumu Dhanalakshmi College, Bharathidasan University. He finished his ME in Computer Science and Engineering from College of Engineering, Anna University. His areas of interest are multicore programming and architecture, programming models, compiler, automata theory, cryptography, and algorithms. He is an expert in subjects like compiler design, formal languages and automata theory, analysis of algorithms. His research area is code generation for multicore architecture.
Welcome to the UGC lecture series on computer science. Previous episode, we have seen the pumping lemma meant for context-free languages, where we have seen what is the pumping lemma, that is the lemma statement, and the tree structure, like what we had as far as the relationship in between the pumping lemma, that is the tree, derivation tree, and the length of the string. And also we have seen that is the some of the examples, like the patterns of the form W followed by W, or it is of the form 0 power n followed by 1 power n followed by 2 power n, where the number of zeros, number of ones and number of twos all are equal in, that is in terms of the count. So, those languages as are proved as context free, non context free languages. Since it is not possible to come up with a there is production grammar, context free grammar, or even push down automata for the languages, we need some there is way to prove them as non context free. We use the pumping lemma meant for context free languages to prove those languages as non context free languages. So, as far as this episode is concerned, we have another topic, that is linear bounded automata. As far as the Chomsky hierarchy is concerned, we have seen the basic class of language is going to be the regular language, and then we had the context free language, and we have seen that there are languages which are not coming under the context free, and now we are moving to the next, that is class of language called context sensitive language. So, it is little, there is wider than, or there is more broader than the context free languages. So, there is a need for, there is studying what those languages are and what is going to be the device meant for the there is context sensitive language, and how we are there is deriving strings using the context sensitive language, and whether it is having a deterministic version or non-deterministic version or both, and what will be the equivalence among the non-deterministic version and a deterministic version. So, those things are all available as far as this episode is concerned. So, first of all, you should know that there is the linear bounded automata. Actually, it was introduced in the year of 1960 by Meigel, that is the deterministic one, and in 1964, Kuroda introduced the non-deterministic linear bounded automata. So, even in the case of deterministic finite automata, that is a finite automata, we had the deterministic version as well as non-deterministic version, and we have proved that the deterministic version of the finite automata and the non-deterministic version of the finite automata have the same power of that is language recognition. But whereas in the when you are coming for the context-free languages, we had deterministic version of the pushdown automata, and we had the non-deterministic version of the pushdown automata. But in terms of the language recognition power, the deterministic version of the pushdown automata lacks the power of that is recognizing all context-free languages. So, DPDA or the deterministic pushdown automata is having the capability to recognize only a subset of the context-free languages rather than the entire context-free language. So, there is a difference in between the language recognition power of the context-free language, that is deterministic version of the pushdown automata, and the non-deterministic version of the pushdown automata. But as far as the linear bounded automata is concerned, here also we have the deterministic version as well as non-deterministic version. But in terms of the language recognition power, you find the deterministic version and the non-deterministic version are having the same power. So, always it is possible to come up with a deterministic version or non-deterministic version, or even the transformation from non-deterministic to deterministic version as far as the linear pushdown automata is concerned, or linear pushdown automata is concerned. So, here we are having the that is the linear bond of an automata definition. So, it is almost similar to the Turing machine, that is non-deterministic version of the Turing machine, but having less power than the Turing machine. So, Turing machine is very similar to that is present day computing devices. Whatever we can do with the help of computing devices, we can do with the help of Turing machines also. So, here it is, as far as linear bond automaton is concerned, it is a restricted form of that. It means that having a tape on the Turing machine, so how long it is possible to move. So, as far as the tape content is concerned, when you go for the Turing machine, so you are free to move the tape on either direction in an infinite number of positions. You can move one position at a time, but you can move on either direction infinitely. But as far as a linear bonded automaton is concerned, so we are restricted to move in between only a range of cells rather than moving in an infinite direction, infinite number of cells. So, there will be some angular brackets being used to denote what is going to be left end and what is going to be right end, and we will be always doing some transformation of the symbols only within the symbols or only those symbols which are bounded by the angular brackets. It is because of the derivation, whatever we are having as far as a context sensitive language is concerned, will never take any that is length more than the length of the string. There is a number of symbols available in this derivation or in the sentential form will never be greater than the number of symbols available in the actual string which we are going to derive. So, then there is no need of going beyond a certain limit. Once you loaded the input string into the tape of the Turing machine, which is here considered as the linear bonded automaton. So, the tape size is more than sufficient for doing all kind of processing to recognize that string. So, that is what we restrict the input within a there is limited number of cells based on the length of the string, and we do transformation only for those cells which are available within that limit. So, that is what the point here. So, the transitions may not print other symbols over the end markers. The end markers are here the that is angular bracket left and angular bracket that is right, and we will never replace them. Another thing is we will never move even left of that or even the right of the end marker for the that is symbols which are available on the tape of the Turing machine is concerned or tape of the linear bonded automaton is concerned. So, that is about the linear bonded automaton, and now we have the grammar which is exclusively meant for the recognizing the context free languages. Context sensitive languages. So, we have a grammar meant for recognizing the context regular languages, we call it as the regular grammar, which is either going to be a left linear one or going to be the right linear one based on where do we append the strings sorry symbols on the derivations are concerned. So, it can be either on the rightmost end or it can be on the leftmost end, based on that we will be calling the grammar as either right linear or the left linear. And then we will be able to come up with some string, and those strings are all in the form that is regular languages. So, we call the grammar as regular grammar. And then we have seen the context free languages, and we have seen that there exists a grammar called context free grammar. So, where the productions are of the form A derives alpha, where A is going to be a variable and alpha is either a variable or a terminal its closure. In the similar manner, we have a grammar meant for recognizing the context sensitive languages. So, we call the grammar as context sensitive grammar. So, it is very similar to the grammar which is context free with almost all the four components of that. We call it as that is V, T, P and S. The set of all variables or non-terminals which are capable of deriving strings of their own, and a terminal set which is nothing but the basic symbols from which we will be generating the strings of the language. And the most important component of that grammar, any grammar, is going to be set of all productions, and then as usual we will be having a starting symbol of the grammar where from we will derive or we will derive any string which is there in the language of the grammar. The main difference in between the context sensitive and context free grammar is lying on the size of the there is a format of the production. So, here we have that is the productions of the form alpha A capital letter that is a variable beta together derives alpha gamma beta. So, that is a place the term that is context sensitive plays a vital role here. So, in the case of context free grammar, we do not have a component like alpha or beta as far as left hand side is concerned, only one variable is there, and that variable is always expanded using any one of the right hand side men for that. But here we have the prefix that is alpha and the suffix that is beta bounded by the variable called a. And as far as the right side is concerned, or it is deriving, the alpha no change, and once again the beta it's of no change, and in between that alpha and beta we have a gamma. So actually what happens is alpha a beta is replaced by alpha gamma beta, and it is not strictly a rule that this a should always be replaced by gamma as far as context sensitive grammar is concerned. But in the case of context free grammar is concerned, the a is going to be always replaced by alpha, so this gamma. So that is the difference between context free and context sensitive. Here the replacement of a by gamma is sensitive to the context where this a is appearing. If a is bounded by alpha and beta, then replacement for a is gamma. If a is, that is bounded by something like alpha and something like eta, then there will be a different replacement for the a, maybe it is going to be some other delta or something like that. So now what this a and that is alpha and beta are all, a is a variable, then alpha and beta belongs to v union t star, that is variable or terminal and its closure, then gamma is going to be v union t plus. So that is another important point which we have to remember there. So always the number of symbols available on the left hand side should be either equal or less than the number of symbols available on the right hand side. So that is an important constraint as far as the productions of context sensitive grammar is concerned. If you are allowing this gamma to be empty, then a, sorry, alpha a beta deriving alpha gamma beta will have less number of symbols on the right hand side than the number of symbols available on the left hand side. But it is strictly not allowed as far as context sensitive grammar is concerned. So this beta, as far as a is concerned, it is going to be single symbol. So as far as this gamma is concerned, it should have at least one symbol. So that is what we have the condition here. This gamma always belongs to v union t plus at least one variable or at least one terminal or the combination of variables and terminals, but the total number of symbols available on the right hand side or the gamma, the number of symbols available in gamma should be at least one. So if this rule is satisfied, then the production is said to be a production in the context sensitive grammar. So now the question is, can we have rules like epsilon rule or not? So to, if you want to have an epsilon rule, so what will be the problem here is, if epsilon is allowed on the right hand side, then it can be used as a replacement for something. So when we are introducing epsilon on the right hand side, the number of symbols available on the right hand side will automatically reduce. We shall have a break. After the break, we will continue the lecture. Welcome back. So now the issue is, we can have an epsilon on the right hand side of a production for some variable s, only if this particular variable is not at all appearing on any of the right hand sides of the productions. If a variable is having a production rule for that is called epsilon, and if the variable is allowed to appear on the right hand side of the production, then when you are introducing the right hand side for some derivation, automatically the right hand side derivation is going to have lesser length than the left hand side derivation, but it is not allowed as far as any context sensitive derivation is concerned or in the language derivation is concerned. So what is very important is, if you want to have an epsilon rule, okay, we can have it, no problem, but the variable which derives the epsilon should never be appearing on the right hand side of any production rule. So in that case, since it is not at all available on the right hand side of any production, there is no question of having any derivation whose length is going to be lesser in length than the number of symbols available on the left hand side. So it is allowed to have epsilon production, but we must ensure that the variable deriving that epsilon should never be on the right hand side of any of the productions. This is what about the definition for the context sensitive grammar. So the productions are always of the form alpha a beta deriving alpha gamma beta, where gamma is going to be at least one symbol or even more, alpha, beta can be even epsilon also, no problem, and A is going to be a single variable. So, now we have this condition here. So, the first condition which I have already stated, that is alpha A beta should be less than or equal to, the length of alpha A beta should be less than or equal to alpha gamma beta. So, that is more clear as long as the number of symbols available in this gamma is going to be at least 1. So, in the case of number of symbols available in gamma is at least exactly 1, then both sides are going to have the same length, and as long as more symbols are there in the that is gamma, then the length of the right hand side is going to be greater than the length of the left hand side. And we call this context sensitive grammars as that is non contracting grammars or non reducing grammar, because as long as the derivation is going to be used, every time when you find a variable on the left hand side, it will be replaced by a right hand side, where the right hand side contains more symbols than the number of symbols available on the left hand side. So, what will happen is, it is always expanding the that is derivation or the length of the sentential form. Since we are always expanding the length of the sentential form to match the exact string which we want to derive, we will be calling it as non-contracting, that is grammars. So, here we have one simple example. So, you can see that the starting symbol is going to be yes, and then we are having a derivation, that is production rule, that is A, S, B and C. So, now what happens is, once again this S is expanded by using A, S, B, C. So, we are having A, S, B, C, already B, C are all available. So, now we are going for A, that is expanding this S once again by another rule called, that is B, C. So, that is going not B, C, that is A, B, C. So, we will be having, that is A, B, then C is there, then followed by B, C and B, C. Next it is going to be that is S is replaced by that is completely it is not there. Now, we are having only two variables B and another one is going to be B. So, we are having another replacement for B here, that is B is replaced by B, C. So, here also we find that the number of symbols available on that the B is the only variable which is going to be replaced here, but what is the replacement given for this B is going to be B followed by C. So, the left hand side we have only one B, and the right hand side we are having that is two number of symbols, one is capital B and another one is going to be small c. So, that is what the derivation we are having here, and the next one what happens is, so we have that is this capital B replaced by a B C. So, that is we are having that is B, then we will be having that is B followed by triple C, and finally, we are having that is triple A followed by triple B followed by triple C. So, the grammar what we have here is actually capable of generating a string of the form 0 power n followed by or a power n followed by b power n followed by c power n. Actually, we have proved this language as non context free using the pumping lemma for context free languages. So, a power n followed by b power n followed by c power n is not going to be a context free language, since the number of a's and number of b's and number of c's are exactly to be same, which cannot be verified with the help of a single stack which is there in the push down automata. Since the same language could be recognized with the help of a linear bounded automata or the context sensitive grammar, we can easily claim that the context sensitive grammar or context sensitive language is more powerful than the context free languages. So, one example for the context free language, so context free grammar here we are having is, so that is for S is A, S, B, C, or this S can be even A, B, C. So, we find that the number of symbols available on the left hand side is less than the number of symbols available on the right hand side, and here also the number of symbols available on the left hand side is less than the number of symbols available on the right hand side. Then we have the third rule where C, B is replaced by B, C. Still we find the number of symbols available on the left hand side is equal to the number of symbols available on the right hand side. So, the replacement what we have done is that is the C B together is replaced by B C, and then B B it is going to be replaced by B followed by small b. So, wherever we are having a small b followed by a capital B, the output is going to be the small b followed once again by B. So, this is one simple that is context free grammar, sorry, context sensitive grammar, where the productions are all satisfying the properties of the context sensitive grammar. Now, when you are looking at the actual language being generated by this context free language, context sensitive language, we have that is a power n, b power n, c power n, where n is going to be greater than or equal to 1. So, at least we will be having this string called that is a, b, c generated by that. So, for example, suppose if I am having that is s is deriving a, s, b, c, and then we can have that is this s replacing your that is a, b, c. So, we can have that is two number of a's followed by a b followed by then once again a c followed by like that is b, c. So, this c, b you can replace it by b, c to have that is b followed by b and then it will be replaced by b, b to get the strings of the form a power 2, b power 2 and even c power 2. So, the language is going to be of the form a power n followed by b power n followed by c power n. So, when we are looking at the actual that is meaning of these context sensitive grammars, we find it is going to be more powerful than the that is the context free languages, because the class of language recognized by the context sensitive grammar is more than the class of language the which is followed by which is recognized by context free grammar. That is first one. And as far as the context sensitive grammar is concerned, the replacement is always context bound. So, we can say that if something if you want to replace some x by some y, just by seeing that is x, you cannot decide whether that is going to be replaced by y or not. So, you should see that what is going to be on the left hand side of the x and what follows that x. So, what precedes that x and what follows that x will determine what is going to be replacement given for that. So, it is grammar, it can be used to surrounding characters are deciding what to do in different things for with a different variable. So, instead of always having to do the same thing every time. So, in the case of context free languages, a variable will be almost doing all the same job every time wherever it is available, but that is not true in the case of context sensitive grammars that is because they are completely based on the context where a particular variable is existing. And all the productions in the context sensitive grammars are non-contracting. So, as I already explained, since the number of symbols available on the left hand side should be less than or equal to the number of symbols available on the right hand side, then always the derivation's length is either going to be retained as same or it will be more than the number of symbols available on the left hand side. So, you will be calling the grammar or the context sensitive grammars as non-contracting. And so, the ultimate that is implication there is, so they never result in the length of the that is intermediate string being reduced. So, always the number of symbols available in the intermediate position of the strings is getting increased or being retained in the same. So, that is about your the context sensitive grammars, and we have seen the there is examples for context sensitive grammar also. So, that is the grammar which is meant for generating the language a power n, b power n followed by c power n, and that is possible since we are having the Turing machine, its tape is available. And the only restriction we are having as far as the Turing machine tape with respect to the context sensitive grammar or in the linear bound automaton is the bound. So, what is going to be the left end and what is going to be the right end of the Turing machine tape, it is already fixed. So, you cannot move towards beyond the left end of the tape, and similarly we cannot move beyond the right end of the tape. So, that limit is the only restriction as far as the Turing machine is concerned. That is why we call it as linearly bound an automaton. So, about that is about your context sensitive languages. And now, we are since it is also going to be a class of language that is the as mentioned in the Chomsky's hierarchy along with that is the regular languages, context free languages and even context sensitive languages. So, we need to find out the closure properties of the context sensitive language also. As far as regular languages are concerned, we have seen the closure properties like union, that is even concatenation, reversal. So, they all were satisfied by the regular languages. And when we are studying the context free language closure property, so we proved that it is satisfying the union operation, concatenation operation, reversal and even closure, but whereas the context free languages are not satisfying the operation called intersection. And we have shown that with the help of an example that the intersection of two context free languages is not necessarily be context free. But when you are coming to the closure properties of that is the context sensitive languages, we find that the union operation, the concatenation operation and even the intersection operation, that is all of them are closed as far as the context sensitive languages are concerned. So, that is our closure properties is the context sensitive languages are closed under union, concatenation and even intersection also. And later people have proved that the context sensitive languages are even satisfying the closure properties called, that is, the complementation also. So, when you find that intersection is satisfied and then complementation is satisfied, you can very easily prove that the difference is going to be the one which is also going to be satisfied because of the that is algebraic properties, we can very easily find out they are equivalent. So, that can also be proved that. So, almost that is the important properties of the closures, they are all satisfied by the context sensitive languages are that is concerned. So, the next part of the topic is going to be the Turing machines. So, so far we were studying only the language recognition components like the finite automata we have studied, and then it is the that is pushed down automata, and then the linear bounded automata. These are all the various recognizers we meant for that is learning the regular languages, then it is context free languages, and then context sensitive languages. As far as the context sensitive language is concerned, it is more powerful than the context free languages. So, it is really that is useful in describing all programming that is language syntaxes with the help of the context sensitive languages, especially the syntax of the Pascal can be represented completely in terms of the context sensitive that is languages. But in the case of regular languages, like you can describe the token structures of the programming languages like the operators, then the keywords or even identifiers or constants, they all can be represented in terms of the context, the regular languages. And the context free languages can be used for describing that is almost all the that is programming language constructs like the if statement or the while statement or even the assignment statement, the syntax of the expressions. So, they can be used for they can be represented or described with the help of the context free grammar. And more complex construct can be recognized even with the help of the context sensitive grammars also. So, finite automata is there, pushed automata is there, and even then there is the linear bounded automata is also there. All these are only recognizers, but now we have a new device which is meant for both recognition as well as for that is computation. So, we call it as the Turing machine. So, this is a device which is capable of doing all the jobs done by the finite automata, then it is pushed in automata, then even the that is the linear bounded automata also. But in the case of when you are looking at the Chomsky hierarchy, we find the Turing machine language is going to be a language called a recursive language as well as recursively enumerable languages. And the there is languages like regular languages, the context free languages, the context sensitive languages, they are all coming as the subset of the language called that is recursive as well as recursively enumerable languages. Since they are all going to be subset of these languages, we can very easily claim that the Turing machine will be certainly capable of recognizing the regular language, context free language, context sensitive language, and even beyond that we have the language called recursive and then another one is called recursively enumerable language. So, all these are possible with the help of the Turing machines. Let us see that is what this Turing machine is actually. So, it is going to be a mathematical model of that is any computer device, computing device. And what is the axis that is where really we need some storage for recognition of the strings or even for the computation and all. In the case of finite automata, we have no concept of storage. In the case of pushed down automata, we had a that is stack. In the case of linear bounded automata, we had a bounded tape, that is tape with the restriction. So, can we move how long we will be able to move towards left and how long we will be able to move towards right. So, that kind of restrictions were there as far as the tape being used by the linear bounded automata is concerned. But in the case of Turing machine, we do not have any bound at all. We will be given a tape which is going to be infinite in both directions. So, you can move towards the right or left any number of that is any amount of time or any number of positions or any amount of time. And what class of language it is going to recognize? So, it is going to recognize the language called recursively enumerable set, and also it is capable of computing partially recursive functions also. So, now look at the that is your structure of the Turing machine model. So, this is what your tape, and we have symbols that is x 1, x2, x3, etc. up to some xi, and then we are having the symbols, and that is finally it is going to be xn. So, the only that is contents of the symbol, that is your tape, is represented by x1, x2, x3, etc. up to xn. But we know that the tape is going to be infinite on both directions, sequentially it is going to be infinite. So, what will happen on the other cells? Having only n number of symbols, what will happen for the remaining symbols, the remaining cells? So, we assume that those cells are completely blank. So, we cannot leave some simply blank. So, we will be having a special symbol B, which is there in a cell means it is denoting B. So, it is denoted by B. So, it will be available on both sides of the tape, but there is no question of separating the inputs by B. So, if you want to still separate the inputs, or if you want to load multiple number of inputs, so some marker symbols can be introduced in between the inputs to differentiate what is the first input and what is the second, etcetera, etcetera. So, here the tape content, and with there is blank on the left end, left, and even the blank on the right, and in between them we are having there is x1 to there is xn. So, we have a finite control, it is going to be a function called there is a transition function, and we call here it as finite control. That will be taking care of that is how the control is moving towards the right or to moving towards the left. So, we divide the tape into there is cells, and the tape head is the job of the tape head is moving towards left or it will be towards right as what the finite control says. But it is very important to understand that the finite control moves one cell at a time, it is not more than that. So, and another thing is what we can have in each cell. At the most one symbol can be there in each cell. So, each cell can hold that is exactly that is one of a that is finite number of tape symbols. So, earlier we used to call them as that is input symbols, and but here we call it as the tape symbols. So, in the case of the finite automata, we never have had a that is storage, but whereas in the case of Pushkin automata, we had storage, we will be both reading as well as writing symbols. As far as the that is your stack is concerned, along with the stack is an additional component along with the input buffer. So, we had two number of that is alphabets, one is the tape all that is your stack alphabet, and another one is like the input alphabet. So, input alphabet is always having that is what the input contains, or the what are the inputs, or how the input is formed from the symbols. And the tape alphabet, sorry, the Pushkin automata, in the case of that, we will be having the stack. So, stack alphabet is completely going to be a different one. So, what can be pushed onto a stack and what can be popped out of the stack? So, they will be called the stack alphabet. But as far as the Turing machine is concerned, we do not have anything called any concept called that is input, that is tape or something like. So, we have a tape, there only we will be loading the input also, and even the output is also going to exist on the tape only. So, every time we will be reading a symbol, and you can once again simply leave that symbol as it is on the tape, or you can rewrite this symbol in the tape itself. So, the tape here is used both as input medium as well as the output medium. So, there should be provision always for reading as well as writing one cell at a time as far as the tape is concerned in the case of your Turing machine model. So, each cell can hold exactly one that is of a finite number of tape symbols. So, we are defining only tape symbols, but there is no question of having an input symbol or anything. So, in a move there is suppose if you want to there is how the Turing machine is actually that is working when it is processing the symbols. So, depending upon the symbol that is being scanned by the that is tape head and the state of the finite control. So, what will happen is the finite control it is capable of changing the state or printing a symbol on the tape or moving its head towards left or it is going to be the right of that is one cell. So, the tape head or the finite control is capable of moving towards left or capable of moving towards right. So, by the time when it is moving, we can go for that is rewriting that is the contents with the help of that is writing symbols one at a time, or you can even just read that. So, that is how the your Turing machine is the finite control on the Turing machine is that is behaving. So, let me summarize that is what we had as far as this particular episode is concerned. So, we studied the context sensitive languages, and the recognizer for the context sensitive language is going to be either the context sensitive grammar or it is going to be the linear bounded automata. And Also, we have seen that the two versions of linear bounded automata are available. One is the deterministic version and another is the non-deterministic version, and both are having the same power as far as the language recognition power is concerned. And also the class of language recognized by the linear bounded automaton is more than the class of language that could be recognized by any, that is context sensitive, sorry, context free grammar or context free the push down automata. As far as the question component is concerned, so the what is the advantage really in this context sensitive languages, and how the LBA recognizes context sensitive language, that is also another important thing, because earlier we have seen that push down automata were using that is a stack, but here it is a tape being used. How the tape contents are being organized and how do we limit that it is not going beyond the left and beyond the right after some position. So, those things are very important here. And what is the restriction, that is what are the restrictions available on productions, so regarding that. So, context sensitive grammar is differing from the context free grammar only in terms of the productions being that is used. So, what are the restrictions available on writing productions? So, that is another thing as far as context sensitive grammar is concerned. So, with this I conclude this particular episode. So, thank you.